And we're talking about graphing in order to solve systems. You did a graphing review yesterday, graphing using the intercept method, graphing using slope-intercept form. So that's what we're talking about today. You've never worked with systems before, I don't think. So we're going to first talk about what a system is and what a solution to a system is. A system of equations is a set of two or more. In algebra 1, it will just be two. We're not going to do more than two equations or inequalities. So for us, it's really going to be just two. It's going to be a set of two or more equations with two or more variables. So a system of equations is a set of two or more equations with two or more variables. I really liked this kind of stuff. I kind of grooved on this as a kind of a dorky math student. And so when we got to college and we were starting working with four, five, six equations with six variables, it was really kind of fun. But I don't think normal people really find that to be fun. But two equations with two variables, not a big deal. They look like this. Typically, they've got this the curly brackets there, and they'll look like 2x plus 4y equals 18, or y equals negative 4x minus 7. Just two equations, two variables. A lot of the time, you will find them without the curly bracket. But if you see the curly bracket, it just means these things go together. But very often, you'll see in your examples, like these examples here, there is no curly bracket. Mostly in this case, it's because I couldn't figure out how to get the curly bracket on there in the right way. What is the solution to a system? A solution of a system is an ordered pair that makes, and this is important. You know how you're going to know it's important? Because it's in all caps. An ordered pair that makes both equations true. And I say both in this case because, or an ordered pair in this case, because we are only working with two equations with two unknowns or two variables. So I mean both equations true. So given that, this next example, it says tell whether negative 2, 4 is a solution to none, one, or both of the equations. Now, if it's a solution to both of the equations, it's also called a solution to the system. So if this right here is a solution to both of the equations, it's a solution to the system. So we're going to take, remember this is x and this is y. We're going to take negative 2 and put it in for x and 4 and put it in for y for each one of these. So here we've got y, which is 4. Is 4 equal to 4 times negative 2 minus 2? Is 4 equal to negative 8 minus 2? We can answer that question right now, can't we? It's not a solution, is it? So it's not. Okay, so that's the first one. No, it's not a solution. Let's check this next one. 2 times x, which is negative 2, plus y is 4. Does that give us 0? 2 times negative 2 is negative 4. Does that give us 0? Yes. So we had to say whether it's a solution to none, one, or both. The answer in this case is it's a solution of one of the equations. If it's a solution to one of the equations, is it a solution to the system? No. It's the system. Okay? You give that one a shot. Okay. So we can see here it worked in the first one. It didn't work in the second one, so this is a solution to one. Okay, go ahead and check that next one. Let's check here.
Where's my
name? 4 equals negative 2 squared. What's negative 2 times negative 2? It's positive 4, so that's good. Then it is both. So then we've got negative 2 equals, oops, I'm sorry. Keep messing that up. 4 equals 1 half of negative 2 plus 5. That right there is negative 1, so we're good there. So this works in both equations. What does that mean?
So
It's a solution to or of the system. And last but not least, let's see, 2 times negative 2 minus 3 times 4 equals 18. Negative 4 minus 12 does not equal 18, so it's not this one. The answer is no for that one. And then 4 equals 1/3 times negative 2 minus 2. Hey, I don't know what this is over here, but I do know it's not 4. I don't know what it is, but it's not 4. So this is a solution to none of the equations. So we only had one that was a solution, that one system that negative 2, 4 was a solution of, and that was this one right here. That was the only one, the only system that it was a solution. Okay, now, the next three problems are not going to be a big deal. We're just solving by graphing. When we're graphing this thing right here, when we're solving this by graphing, what we need to do is graph both equations. The spot where they intersect is the solution. So in looking at this, Carter, where should I start on this first one? We should start at 1 on the graph. Where? Just be more specific. Yep, on the y-axis. We're starting at 1 on the y-axis, right there. And then what is my slope? Angel, what's my slope for this one? 2 over 1. I like that he just said 2 over 1. So from here, we are going to rise 2 and run 1. And if you're smart, which I obviously must not be, you're going to have rulers when you do this because it's a lot easier. Because I didn't give you a ruler, so do it the best job you can of drawing a straight line. Okay, so there's our first. That's no big deal. Caden, you can do that in your sleep, can't you, at this point? Emma, where should I start for this one? What's my starting point? For the top one, the starting point was 1. What's my starting point here?
4.
Yep, and it's a negative 4. So we're going to start down here. What's my slope, Jonathan? Negative 3 over 1. So from here, we would go down 3, but I don't like that because it falls off the graph. So instead of doing negative 3 over 1, I'm just going to do 3 over negative 1. So now what I can do is from here I can go up 3 and to the left 1. Oh, look, that's rather convenient. So from here I went up 3 because it's positive 3 and left 1 because it's negative 1. And then the question is, what's you're told to solve? What's the solution? Bless you. This is just the graph. The solution is what? Negative 1, negative 1. And if we're going to check that, we're going to take these numbers and put them in both of the equations and make sure. Is negative 1 equal to 2 times negative 1 plus 1? I'm checking this one right here. Is negative 1 equal to negative 2 plus 1? Yep. Let's check this one. Is negative 1, that's what my y is, equal to negative 3 times negative 1 minus 4? Is negative 1 equal to, that's 3. Is this equal? Yep. So we're in good shape there. We're in a good place. So this right here is the solution to the system. It's okay if you write your solution this way. It's also okay if you write x equals negative 1 and y equals negative 1. I don't care which way you write it. They're both fine. Now we have equations that are in, the top one is in standard form. So we've got 3x plus 4y equals 12. I need to find the x-intercept and the y-intercept. If y is 0, what am I left with, Josh? If y is 0, what am I left with in this equation? I'm going to come back to you on the next.
3x.
Yep, 3x equals 12. So what's x?
4.
It's not 4 because that's 4. It's 4 because 3 times 4 gives us 12. Mariah, if x is 0, what's left in the equation? If x is 0, what's left in this equation? What? More. Carter, can you help her there? For y equals 12, so what's y? 3. Okay, so we've got 2 points. Let's graph those. You reviewed that yesterday. Four, zero, zero, 3. Use your handy dandy ruler that you don't have, because I dropped the ball. And the next one's pretty easy to graph. Keen, where should I start on this bottom one?
3.
Starting at 3 on the?
On the y-axis.
Ooh, that's right here. I think I already know what the solution is. And then, what do I want to use? Casey? Wait, no. Lexi. My bad. Negative 3 over 4. So from here, we go down 3 and right 4. Wait, what'd you say, Keaton?
They're both the same.
It's the same stinking line. Same line. It's the same line. What does that mean? It has an infinite number of solutions. If a point works in the top equation, it also works in the bottom equation. It's the same line. Let's see. Hint. Okay, here we go. We've got another one in standard form. 2x minus 4y equals 8. Let's find the x-intercept, and let's find the y-intercept. Do that, please. Okay, so we put the 0 in for y and find out what x is, put the 0 in for x and find out what y is. We plot those and graph it. And then for this last one, it graphs pretty quickly. Emma, where should I start on this one? Yep, 2. Where? On the what? Yep, on the y-axis, so 2 right here. And then my slope is 1 over 2. So rise 1, run 2. Oh! Marwa said, will we ever have no solutions? Or she said something like that. What do you see about those two lines? They're parallel. Those two lines are parallel. So in this case, because the lines are parallel, we have no solutions. Because where's the solution? The solution is the intersection point. Did I say that earlier? Ooh, right here, we should add to this. An ordered pair that makes both equations true, or the intersection point of graphs. They don't have to be lines, but that's what we're doing right now. The intersection point of the graphs. Whoopsie daisy. Okay, this chart is going to help you. This is all you need for that last page, is this chart that we're going to fill out right now. So when we draw parallel lines, what does the graph look like? They look like parallel lines. If they intersect, they're going to touch someplace. They might have a larger obtuse angle and smaller acute angle, but it doesn't matter. They're going to intersect. This is a word you probably don't know, coincident. You do know. You know what coincidence means probably in the real world, don't you? Things happen and it's coincidence that they both happened. They kind of both happened at the same time. Coincidence. Kind of, yep. Coincident lines are when you have one line falls right on top of the other. They're the same line. And then how many solutions do parallel lines have? Zero. Or we say no solutions. That doesn't mean zero is the solution. That means there are no solutions at all. How many solutions for intersecting lines? Well, where do they touch? In one spot. So there's one solution. How many solutions do coincident lines have? An infinite number. And then this other part, this is where I wanted you to have your highlighters out, because I want you to focus on the slope-intercept form appearance. Here's an example of two equations in slope-intercept form that will be parallel. And what's important here is that the slopes have to be the same and the y-intercepts have to be different. Same, different. If they're intersecting lines, am I going too fast? If two lines intersect, that means they can't have the same slope. So y equals, here's an example, 8x minus 9, and y equals 2/3 x plus 5. And what's important here is that these slopes are not the same.
Neither is
the y-intercepts don't matter. They can be the same, but it doesn't matter. They can still intersect. So what's important here? These are different. The slopes have to be different. And then for the bottom part, if they're in, I'm going too fast again, aren't I? Okay. For the bottom part, to know that they're coincident, we need to rewrite them in slope-intercept form, and we need to have the same slope and the same y-intercept. Same slope, same y-intercept.
Differently, like
6 minus 4x, and then that's 6 plus 4x, it'd still be the same thing. You know what? Here's another one. Here's another example. Let's say you have y equals 4x plus 6. And y minus 6 equals 4x. There's your system. To know whether they're parallel or coincident or have one single intersecting point, you want to isolate that y. How would you get that y by itself? Add 6 to both sides. And that leaves you with y equals 4x plus 6. Oh, lo and behold, they didn't look the same at first. But when we rewrite that with the y by itself, they are the same. So those would be coincident lines. Now, if in the future we're going to solve some equations, this won't help you with today's homework. It's going to help you with stuff you start to do tomorrow and the next day. Substitution elimination. When there are no solutions, you would end up with something that looks like this. Oh, wait a minute. My apologies. I've got this backwards. You'd end up with like 5 equals 8. And that should be familiar to you from when we solved equations earlier. When there is one solution, we end up with x equals some number. It could be x equals negative 5. You end up with an actual value. It could be x equals 0. X equals 0 would be okay. When there are an infinite number of solutions, we end up with something like 5 equals 5. Okay, so that is it in a nutshell. Your homework today is to do page 3. Let's take a look, make sure we're on the same place. If you want to check to see if this is the solution to the system, it needs to make both equations true. If you check the first equation and it doesn't work, it's already not a solution to a system. You don't even need to check the next one. Again, for this one, to check to see if that's a solution to the system, you have to make sure it makes both of these true. For this right here, what is the solution to the system of equations shown? This should be really fast. Where's the solution? It's where they intersect. This one right here, do some graphing and drawing based on what they give you in this problem. There's a problem. Hey, this is what I'd do if I were you. There's a problem just like this on your test. That's a test question, guaranteed. This right here, you just have to graph those and find the intersecting point. Make sure you write down what the solution is. This is application problem, but fairly easy. Taking a look at this. You are testing fertilizer on bamboo plants C and D. Plant C is 7 centimeters tall. Oh, wait, plant C. How tall is it to start? 7 centimeters tall. And it's growing at a rate, that means that's a slope, of 1 centimeter per day. And that's going to equal the height. And then what's D? Plant D is 1 centimeter tall and is growing at a rate of 3 centimeters per day. Now you have to graph these on this coordinate plane, find the solution set. Same thing for number 8. And then on page 5, I believe all of this can be answered using that table that we just filled out. Good luck. I don't think it will be that big a deal.